Yeah, I mean, I finished it. Hi, we're just waiting for the teams to join, after which we'll begin with the finals.
Hi, both members of Team 05 are here.
begin. Good afternoon, everyone. We're just waiting for one participant. We'll be beginning shortly. We're sorry for the delay.
Chat is it, right?
Hello, am I audible?
Hello. Yes. Okay. All right, I think all participants and judges and guests are here. We will begin now.
Okay. I'll start now. A very good afternoon to one and all present here today. The opinions expressed and the points put forward by our participants have been extremely enlightening and intriguing. They have provided us with multifarious dimensions on both the topics and have left us to ponder on eclectic avenues raised during the debate. We are grateful to each of you who have attended the semi-finals, and we hope that we can see you here during the final. The two teams have made it through rigorous rounds of debates and arguments and proved their points with utmost candor and conduct. We have all been fortunate enough to witness such mind-blowing debates to win the title of CRMD. And on this note, I would like to welcome you all to the last and final round of the Conseil Rodrigues Memorial Debate 2020. There's a time for debate and a time for consensus. There's a time for advocacy and a time for principles. And I believe this time calls for a debate. A very warm welcome to our local superior, Reverend Father Peter D'Souza, our director, Father Reverend Valerian D'Souza, our principal, Dr. Srija Unnikrishnan, along with members of the faculty and staff and our fellow students. We feel honored to have present here today on this joyous occasion our chief guest, retired Major General C.P. Singh. He was commissioned into the Indian Army in December 1979. After 36 years of meritorious service in the Indian Army, he retired from active service on the 31st December 2015. General C.P. Singh was awarded mention in dispatches by the President for gallantry in O.P. Pavan, Sri Lanka. He has also been awarded commendations by four Army commanders for distinguished service in various appointments. Three times cancer survivor, the young veteran is a fitness enthusiast, cycling 12 walking 6 kilometers every day, along with a keen interest in golf and other sports. Let us all greet sir with great enthusiasm. Our guest of honor for the Conseil Rodrigues Memorial Debate 2020, we have Ms. Nidhi Salgame, the first woman to drive from Delhi to London and the first Indian and on the Road of Bones in Siberia. She is an extreme terrain driver, outdoor educator, off-road jeeper, and she recently created history by leading the first team of women drivers to Loma Thang in Nepal, which is one of the most treacherous roads in the world. She brings in the zeal and hunger to go where no one has, and in a source of inspiration and empowerment to all. professions. Judge is Meera Bharwani, the diverse experience of more than 17 years in training students. She has an expertise to teach both business communications and literature. She has taught at a wide array of institutes like VJTI, Sardar Patel Institute of Technology, Xavier Institute of Engineering, Narasimha Mohanty Institute of Management Studies, Champlain College in Vermont, USA, Thakur College of Engineering and Technology, and Ram Narayan Ruya College, among others. We are overjoyed to have you with us, ma'am. And last but not the least, we have Roli Srivastava, who is an award-winning journalist with the Thomson Reuters Foundation and reports on gender, health, migration, and slavery in supply chains, focusing mainly on India's marginalized community. In a career spanning over two decades, she has worked with major Indian newspapers, including The Hindu, where she was deputy editor, and The Times of India, where she was editor, special project. Her investigation won her the Fetisov Journalism Award Bronze in 2019 and a nomination for Journalist of the Year in Drum Online Media Awards. She is a guest faculty at media schools and an online speaker at international journalism conferences. Now then, my lovely audience, I'm sure you are as excited as I am. So kindly brace yourselves for the last and final round of the Conseil Rodrigues Memorial Debate. I would now request a moderator to take over. But before that, I would like to call Purav Bharadwaj, who will announce the rules and the motion of the debate for today.
A very good afternoon to one and all present here. The motion before this house is, in a world of skeptics, this house prefers a world where epistemic humility is widely accepted over skepticism as the dominant paradigm. To understand this motion in its entirety, we have to pay attention to two words being operative in the motion. The first is epistemic humility, and the second is, again, skepticism. Epistemic humility refers to the rooted recognition that knowledge of the world is always interpreted, structured, and filtered by the observer, and that as such, any pronouncements must be built on the recognition of the observer's inability to grasp the world in itself. Very simply, what that means is that epistemic humility operates on the assumption that there is one limitation to the amount of knowledge that an individual may possess, and second, that the frame of reference of an individual constructs certain biases, which in turn result to some disillusionment of determinism in the reality of the world. On the other hand, skepticism operates on the assumption that an individual starts from a point of subjective correctness. That is, that what an individual believes or understands is correct, and then that individual uses that understanding and belief to challenge status quo or dominant paradigms. I would like to congratulate both teams for making it to the finals and wish them all the very best for the debate that is about to come. Here.
I would now request the moderator, Raul Murray, to take over from here. Raul, you're not audible.
Hello.
Yeah, you can go now.
Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Okay, great. Thank you. Good morning to one and all, and welcome to the final round of the Conseil Rodrigues Memorial Debate. Congratulations to both teams for reaching the finals, and I wish you all good luck. Before we begin this debate, can I have a verbal confirmation from both teams about the stability of the internet connection proposition?
Hi, Rob.
Hello.
Well, it's great to be here. Thank you for inviting us.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Very much stable. Thank you so much.
All right. Great. And opposition?
Hi. Great to be here. Am I audible and visible?
Yes, you are.
Hi.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you now. Yeah. So a few rules. I'd like you to keep your mic and your camera on at all times during the debate, even when you're not speaking. Okay. So with this, I'd like to start the debate by greeting everyone present here, the participants, the judges, adjudicator, chief guest, and everyone else, a very good morning. The motion, I will restate it, is in a world of skeptics, this house prefers a world where epistemic humility is widely accepted over skepticism as the dominant paradigm. Representing the proposition is team code CMD01. To my opposition, I have CMD05. Let us begin with the opening speeches. Before that, do you guys, can I tell you about the time frames, or are you all aware of it?
Please, can you reinstate the time frame?
I will reinstate the time frame. Yeah. Okay. So you have an opening speech of 5 minutes. You have your refutation round of 25 minutes and your closing speech of 5 minutes. Your opening speech of 5 minutes, unless otherwise stated, you will be given a warning bell or a warning in the chat box at 4:30. Okay. And a warning to conclude your opening speech at 5 minutes. Proposition, if you could begin your opening speech. Before we begin, may I know if you would like a warning bell or a message in the chat box?
Yes, requesting some moderator to provide a warning bell at 3, 4, 4:45, and 5. Requesting the same to the moderator that please text it on the chat box and not announce it when I'm speaking. And finally, I'll be keeping a time for myself as well, so please see to it. You start only when I start speaking.
Yes.
Thank you so much, sir. Although I do not suppose that either of us knows anything really beautiful or good, I'm better off than he is. And you know why? For he knows something and thinks that he knows everything. I neither know nor think that I know. A very good afternoon to one and all present here. In the world of skeptics, this house proposes a world where epistemic humility is widely accepted over skepticism as a dominant paradigm. Skepticism is defined as a slightly pessimistic naysayer and generally holds a very questioning attitude towards one or more putative instances of knowledge and believes that all the knowledge that they possess is enough to know the truth, and based on the truth alone, this possessed truth alone, do all the fundamental functions of life function accordingly in the same track and leading to a dissolution to the truth of the world. In the philosophy of science, epistemic humility, as rightly mentioned before the debate, refers to the posture of scientific observation rooted in the recognition that one, knowledge of the world is always interpreted, structured, and filtered by the observer. And second, scientific pronouncement must be built on the recognition of the observer's inability to grasp the world currently in itself. Psi proposition would have three fundamental core ideas that they would like to present today. The first one, the idea of a frame of reference. Say in a world of skeptics, I am traveling in a train. I am a skeptic and I'm traveling in a train. And my fellow teammate is standing on the outside of the train in a platform. We both have two individual frame of references acting. One, me sitting inside the train, knowing that the world is moving outside my window. And very strange, I am at inertia. At the same time, the skeptic outside thinks that he is standing on an outside reference. And at the same time, the train is moving and he is at inertial motion. The very fundamental idea that we wish to propose here is that there are two frames of references that both needs to be understood completely in its fruition, for its fruition in a development of a fact and theory. In this case, if each of them, each of the skeptic, would have transferred himself or herself to the other side of the train, to the other frame of reference, maybe they could have understood the fact or the conclusion that they came to was not fundamentally right. In turn, coming on to my second argument, a very fundamental example of how a skeptic in the history of a skeptic world in itself stood and stood his ground and was proved right. For example, in the year 1633, the core of Renaissance, Chief Inquisitor Father Macalini begins the Inquisition of physicist and astronomer Galileo. Galileo was ordered to turn himself to the Holy Office to begin a trial to holding the belief that the earth revolves around the sun, which was deemed heretical by the Catholic Church. Galileo denied that he held the belief in the church's Copernican view, which he very strongly stood against, and in turn continued writing evidence and discussions of his belief. The church had decided the idea that the sun moved around the earth and was an absolute fact of scripture that could not be disputed. And in turn, this time, Galileo's technical argument didn't win that day, but in turn, 300 years later, when Galileo agreed not to teach the heresy anymore, and later, church admitted that Galileo was right and cleared his name of heresy. Only if that the actual skeptics during the change of world of Renaissance could bring about the fundamental knowledge of astronomy 300 years prior to the year it was situated, could have automatically allowed the world to progress at a huge scale, only and only if the church, acting as a skeptic, had encouraged, had the courage to shape their ideas with an epistemic humility, and if possible, the aforementioned change in the frame of reference that was brought about in the first argument portrayed by side proposition. And finally, our third very conclusive evidence is we agree with the notion of skepticism. It is important, but what never occurs to skeptics is the sense of wonder being a paramount. And even for scientists, especially for scientists, Einstein insisted that, in fact, that no great discovery can be made without a sense of awe before the mysteries of the universe. Skeptics know in advance, or they know what right thought is. Skeptics help scientists to maintain objective when performing scientific inquiry and research. It forces them to examine claims, their own and those to others, to be certain that there's sufficient evidence to back this up. But it is not skepticism, but epistemic nature of the scientist that is backed secondarily by skepticism. And hence, the side proposition proudly proposes a shift in the world mechanics where epistemic humility is majoritarian and skepticism is used to keep it in check, very, very fundamental check. This house is proud to propose. Thank you so much.
Thank you, proposition, for your opening speech. I would now request the opposition to provide us with their opening speech. Proposition, do you have any specific time signatures?
Yes, a couple of things. Like if I got a warning at 3:30, 4:30, okay. And then ultimately at 5.
5, okay.
And I'd like them over text. Please don't interrupt me until, of course, I finish my speech.
All right.
Thank you so much. May I begin?
You may begin. I will start when you begin.
Members of the House, allow me the opportunity to recharacterize this debate, right? This debate is one that pertains to philosophical questions of objectivity and truth, right? And we tell you that to that regard, we'll tell you what epistemic humility and skepticism is, because side proposition hasn't done that. Epistemic humility is the assertion that there are no objective facts and any real truth of the world is unattainable due to limitations of human cognitive ability, right? Skepticism, on the other hand, tells you that while complete objectivity over all truths of the world cannot be attained, there are still some valid truths that you can attain in society, right? These valid truths are based on objective wrongs that flow from certain social goals that we have in mind, right? For instance, we all believe in the value of life as an objective in society, and therefore we all objectively know that killing someone, murdering someone is wrong, right? Therefore, the difference really is that the starting point of skepticism is that there is some objectivity that exists and that there are subsequent truths which have to be verified based on these truths and independent evidences. Therefore, the question really is that epistemic humility tells you take everything with a bucket of salt, while skepticism tells you take it with a pinch of salt. Now, moving on, the metric by which you should judge this debate is very clear, right? On which conception of objectivity is the world really better off? And we'll tell you for two reasons why it's better off in the paradigm of skepticism. The first are the inherent and escapable dangers of epistemic humility, while the second are the skepticism is that skepticism produces organic change, which is the only real change we can produce. Turning to the first, let me tell you foundationally that the whole idea of epistemic humility is flawed, because the whole assertion that there are no objective truths is an objective assertion in itself, right? Moving on, we'll tell you that epistemic humility denies actual objective experiences of people that actually exist, because it takes a neutral starting point, right? And this is bad for three reasons. The first is that there is denial of minority oppression. The second is that minority collectivization is prevented. And the third is that majoritarian groups can spread fake news. I'll deal with each of these in turn. Turning to the first, I'll tell you how when you take a neutral starting point, what ends up happening is that majoritarian narrative ends up prevailing in these situations because of power, right? And this power operates in two ways. The first is that because the majority are majority, it means that they're numerically greater than you. There is a greater reason for them to accept views that pertain to them as against the minority, simply because it's their own self-interest. And given the kind of resources and access to power that majoritarian groups have, they control not just the discourse that you have access to, but also socialization. Everything you're told to in school, in society, in movies, all of that is controlled by the majoritarian groups, right? And therefore, actual objective assertions like minority oppression itself is not recognized because no statement is any truer than the others. This is why progressive movements like feminism and the Dalit rights do not recognize epistemic humility, because it doesn't recognize the very objective basis of their oppression. Now, secondly, minority collectivization here is prevented, which is extremely important given that it is the exclusive tool that minorities have using their strength in numbers to fight their oppression. This is prevented in two ways, right? First, there is no acknowledgement of experiences because you think you're wrong, right? We've already spoken about how social discourse and conditioning will tell you you're wrong because it's the dominant one that you're going to be exposed to. And secondly, there is no sharing of experiences to counteract those dominant narratives, right? And sharing of experience is really important because it validates your own feelings and gives you the confidence to speak up. This is why, take the example of the Me Too movement, right? Women are historically told that you shouldn't speak up because you were wrong and you were assaulted because of something wrong that you did. But the point at which women speak up and they share their experiences, they realize that it's actually these problematic men that are the problem and not them. And thirdly, we'll tell you that it's easier to spread fake news because if there is no objective truth, the majority can simply use its access to resources to say whatever it wants to serve its benefit. And this is something we see in the case of Donald Trump and other politicians in the world simply lying and getting access to power. And the emergence of technology through deep fakes is only going to make this worse. And on my second point, I'll tell you why skepticism produces organic change, right? Now, think of the world as it happens, right? It progresses in a certain direction of thesis, antithesis, and then synthesis of both these worlds, right? And there is a certain organic manner in which it proceeds, wherein you have debate and discourse that will help you produce or reach that synthesis, which is the most balanced position, right? We tell you that on their side of the world, there is no debate and discourse that can happen because there is no objective foundations on which you can test things, right? On our side of the house, at least there can be some debate and discourse that will lead to a greater absorption to the point of synthesis, which is what is ideal here, right? And this clash of ideas can only happen on our side of the house. And lastly, we'll tell you that change can only happen through this kind of progressive realization, right? Because overnight change is impossible given the amount of power that majoritarian groups have. Take the example of African Americans, right? They first ended slavery, then we gave them voting rights, and then we gave them socioeconomic rights, and change has to be gradual in this way. For these reasons, Side Opposition is extremely proud to oppose this motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Opposition, for your opening speech. With this, we come to the end of the opening speeches, and we will now move to the refutation rounds. Opposition, you have the first question.
Sure, I'll go ahead.
Yes, you can.
Media is essential to inform public opinion in any democracy. How do you think media will function in a world of epistemic humility?
I'm sorry, how will media function in a world where?
Of epistemic humility, but that where epistemic humility is the dominant narrative.
All right. So we understand that media is very essential to the functioning of democracy. Media is very essential to the functioning of the essence of democracy. Obviously, yes. When we foray into how media will function when the world mechanics change, when epistemic humility is the dominant paradigm over skepticism, we want to say that media will not only ensure that it's thrusting their opinions, that it's not thrusting their opinions about on the dominant paradigm, on the people of the country, but it's collecting different frames of references, as we mentioned in our opening speech, right? A media is supposed to be unbiased, and having different frames of references is what will catalyze the media to be unbiased. If the media were to be operating in a skeptic society, which it is currently, there will be only the portrayal of one side of the news, which the media believes, which the news authorities believes are their subjective truth, and there's a cap on that knowledge.
Commenting on that as well, adding on to my friend's point, the very idea of how generation of a question of media being foraying into the frame of reference, media was born because of the cultural idea that there needs to be portrayal of multiple frames of references. There needs to be portrayal, essential portrayal of each frame of reference, be it African Americans, be it bringing down feminism. These very punctual portrayed ideas are being put out there, and the world which had a skeptic authority or a skeptic mindset towards certain people, like very rightly said, African Americans or women, media stood its ground in showing the very truth, the epistemic humility to create this kind of a foray, is that there are people, there are different frames of references that you need to look into very clearly, very fundamentally, and thus in turn create a world of progress, of theses, antitheses, and pure progressive synthesis. Thank you so much.
We're allowed to comment on...
Yes, you can comment on that. Yes, you can.
We reject propositions, characterization of media in such a world. First of all, we don't understand why in a world where skepticism is the dominant narrative, media is going to be one-sided. Understand that skeptics will exist on either side of the political spectrum, and there will be questions from the left and from the right. There won't be one dominant narrative, but there will be discourse and debate from both sides, and you can hear both sides and they come to some sort of objective truth. But media will suffer from in a world where there is epistemic humility, because every truth is treated as like subjective truth, and where you do not have or cannot have any knowledge, the basis of legitimacy of any piece of news is not going to exist. So the people will not know what kind of truth they can believe and cannot believe. So the entire point of journalism and media, where public opinion is supposed to be informed on the basis of facts, will not exist in a world where epistemic humility is the dominant narrative.
And just adding on one last statement, it's essentially not going to be presenting different viewpoints, right? These viewpoints are going to be contradicting against each other. So the media can't present all of them. So the one that they will present is that of the majority, and therefore the minority's opinion will be left. And that's our assertion.
Okay, proposition, your question.
Very rightly concluded by side opposition. The power and majoritarian ideas that only, even in a world of skeptic, even in a very clear world of skeptic, of contradictions, of ideas, of very fundamental cross ideas of two different kinds of community, where there, and they very clearly say that majoritarianism exists in our paradigm, when there are multiple frames of references, multiple ideas, and multiple skeptics questioning this kind of influence or this kind of ideas. How is it that in a world only dominated by skeptics, a majority that has been developed, in turn fruitful for the society, very rightly mentioned in the opening speech of how a church claimed heresy, and towards a majoritarian church, a majoritarian public of church, and a minority of Renaissance-oriented scientists work against the majority, and how tough it is to work against the majority of skeptics. Thank you so much.
Let's understand that this debate is not happening in an abstract world where this is an academic discussion going on, right? These different frames of references are actually one where there is an actual impact on some people, right? In the real world, when these frame of references contradict each other, the majority has to ensure that its own frame of reference is the dominant one in this position, right? And therefore, even if multiple frames of references exist, there will only be one that will come out on top with respect to the others. And notice how there has been zero engagement from side proposition as to why the majority either doesn't hold enough power to ensure that their narrative doesn't dominate, or that even if they do, people will still have somehow be smart enough to not fall into these lies.
Just to add on to my partner's statements, since this one example is what proposition seems to be using a lot, let me clarify that in that example, the church is not full of skeptics. In fact, the church is one body of majoritarian groups who have strong beliefs, which is the opposite of a skeptic. It was Galileo who was a skeptic who challenged the dominant narrative, and that brought about a change. If epistemic humility was the dominant narrative in that world, then it would have been impossible for Galileo or any scientific individual to challenge the dominant narrative, because the church or any powerful group can come ahead and say that any challenge is subjective and based on like the subjective idea of fact, which cannot really be ascertained because no one can have true knowledge, and therefore delegitimize any challenge. That is why majoritarian narrative is going to continue to prevail in a world where epistemic humility is the dominant narrative.
Thank you so much, side opposition. Let us understand that the church was not the skeptic party in this example. The church was the majoritarian party. The church was the one that was overpowering the one person who had an epistemic humility, that understood that the subjective correctness, which was accepted by the world at that time, that the world is flat, is not correct, and there's much more room for improvement. let us very briefly explain again to side opposition what skepticism is defined as, right? Is that you believe that you start from a place of subjective correctness and you believe that that is the grounds for your truth. If that is the case, if that skeptic is a majoritarian rule in the current government, in the current house, then that means there will be multiple Galileos who will be imprisoned because of their out-of-the-box thinking, because of their thinking that there is more knowledge to be acquired, that they're humile about their knowledge.
Adding on to the point said by my fellow teammate, I would just like to add the beauty of epistemic humility lies in the fact that a minority holds a chance. The majority very fundamentally claiming in a world of skeptics and contradictions of very well mentioned feminism and Dalit society, it was the epistemic humility that was inculcated in the majority later on knowing the truths and in turn creating a society that was progressive. Not the very, very rightly said, we understand that majoritism, you beautifully portray our point that to break majoritism, it is important that epistemic humility is to be brought into picture so that we understand the importance of progress, understand the importance of the nature of these very well said fundamental feminist and Dalit rights, and then in turn move to a progressive society. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, proposition. Opposition, it's your question.
Yeah, just had a very quick question. Do you think Galileo's idea that the earth revolves around the sun, is that a subjective truth or is that a scientific fact?
So can you please repeat the question?
Galileo's assertion that it's the earth that revolves around the sun and not the sun that goes around the earth. Is that a subjective fact that he was trying to state, or was that an objective scientific truth which he was asserting?
Perfect. Thank you so much for the question. I love the question. That's because this whole question will analyze how side proposition is trying to inculcate epistemic humility inside society, right? At the time when Galileo said that the earth revolves around the sun and it's not the sun that revolves around the earth as per the majoritarian belief, at that time for Galileo it was the objective truth, for the majoritarian rule, for the church it was the subjective truth that they believed that the sun revolves around the earth, and that is why they imprisoned Galileo. And that took years of change of scientific evidences that the majority was suppressing, that the majority of skeptics was suppressing the epistemic humile people like Galileo, that they had to prove it over and over again to the majority that was thrusting their belief and their objection that the earth is what revolves around the sun.
Comment on
opposition.
That.
Yes, you can.
That response sort of makes an important concession on part of proposition, where they accept that their own example of Galileo, which was based on an objective truth, is what they want for progress. When it is objective truth that they want for progress, and we prove to you that objective truth is unlikely to exist in a world of epistemic humility, where every idea is just as good as any other idea, then their own argument is self-contradictory and falls flat.
Moreover, they've already proved to you that Galileo was someone who had epistemic humility. They haven't proved the link that if the church was someone who was in a position of epistemic humility, the outcome would have been any different. Okay. And why skepticism, which is a lesser...
Thank you, opposition. Yes.
We can comment on
proposition,
that.
You will have to make it very brief.
Because there was a very clear question from side opposition in this case. So we have
yes.
to comment on that.
Yes, you can, yes. But please okay. make it brief.
The very fundamental understanding that it took 300 years later after the arrest of Galileo to fundamentally prove the very progressive fact that the earth revolves around the sun. And if and only if the church would have inculcated the majority idea of epistemic humility in a world of skeptics, very rightly. Thank you so much, Sai Proposition, for mentioning that, because that is the only reason, that is the only fundamental way in which this would have been explored in 1633 itself. And by now, there would have been a very good chance, if worked since then, we would have been in Mars, we would have been a potential Jupiter targeting world. But sadly, because of that heretic nature, because of the skeptic attitude, and because majority attitude delving into skepticism, it was the epistemic humility that was pushed down, and automatically the theory completely removed in picture until 300 years later when the church realized what the mistake was. Thank you so much. Can we pose a question now?
Proposition, your question. Yes.
Pranay, do you want to pose a question or can I move?
So I'll pose a question.
Fair enough.
Let us dwell back a few decades into our world, right? Skeptics would have believed that there is no way to conceive a child other than natural impregnation by intercourse, right? But it is the people who had epistemic humility is they tested out that there is some room for improvement, that all the knowledge that we have is not enough, and there might be a chance that we can conceive children, unlike what the majoritarian skeptics believe, without natural intercourse. That, can you explain how that in your paradigm, in a world full of skeptics, would have still been allowed?
Well, firstly, we'll tell you that a skeptic would not think that conception is simply limited to current forms of pregnancy, right? That's just bad skepticism. That isn't skepticism per se. Because clearly, remember, we told you that skepticism is the fact that there are some valid objective truths that are based on social goals, right? We gave you the example of how if you value life, you kill someone, that's wrong, right? At the same time, we told you that equality is important. And therefore, if you mistreat someone, that is also wrong, right? That is the limited extent of objectivity that skepticism follows, right? And they're simply trying to mislead you here.
So
just to add on to that point of my fellow speaker, again, like, that question shows a sort of fundamental misunderstanding in the proposition's conceptualization of skepticism. Understand, a skeptic is a person who challenges any idea. So if there is some majoritarian idea, let's say a church idea, or like an idea that there's only one way of concepting a baby, that's not a majoritarian skeptic idea. That's a dominant idea. And when you challenge that idea, that's when you're engaging in skepticism. Also understand that a method of engaging in skepticism is by using epistemic humility. You can be a skeptic and say that my reason for challenging a dominant idea is that no one has full knowledge. So the two are not mutually exclusive. So first, let them answer the question of why exactly a majoritarian idea, like these majority people, are necessarily skeptics. Let's let them define what they understand by the word skeptic, and then let them address the second point that I made.
So, just to comment on that, the very idea of this motion is how it needs a dominant paradigm needs to be created of a community that believes epistemic humility is widely accepted over skepticism. Very rightly said, why side opposition themselves that it is important that the epistemic humility shifts, and we are not denying the role of skepticism in any turn or in any phase. The very idea that skeptics are required to question the theories, the thesis, antithesis, and the synthesis of any aforementioned idea needs to go through the complete crowd of skepticism, understood, but making epistemic humility as the understanding or a dominant paradigm according to side proposition very fundamentally allows the possibility of other dynamics also increasing in this nature. The very understanding that skepticism being the majority committee automatically shifts in the paradigm. Your paradigm just supports the objectivity or the questioning nature. And I would like my side. Yeah. My partner can talk, please.
To add on to the comment, I would like to say that the characterization of an epistemic mild person is that the knowledge of the world is interpreted, structured, and filtered, and that scientific pronouncements may be built on that recognition. The idea of a skeptic, on the other hand, is that the subjective correctness of their own selves is what is their basis of a truth. So even if there is bad skepticism, there is still skepticism. The skeptic person would have said, there is no way that I currently know of, there is no way that a child can be conceived other than natural intercourse. The epistemic humile person proved to the skeptic that there is a way to conceive a child without natural intercourse. And that is when skepticism finally lost the battle of majority, when minority conclusively proved that skeptics are standard corrected. Thank you.
May I proceed with my question?
Opposition, yes, you can proceed with your question.
You've yourself said that epistemic humility is one where there is no sense of objectivity or no real truths that you understand, right? That in this kind of a world, especially when the majoritarian groups have greater influence and power, how are you going to ensure that something as basic as minority oppression is recognized, since it is not considered to be objective?
Okay. You want to take you can take it. It's okay. You want to take it, you take it. Le.
All right. So A, it is gross mischaracterization on side of opposition when they say that we never said, we said that epistemic humility is only objective. We never mentioned that. Second, how do we take care of the minority? Well, the current minority, the minority oppressions, currently it's very ironic that you ask that question because people who have epistemic humility are the current minority, right? And that is the paradigm that we're trying to change. After we change that paradigm, the skeptics become the minority, right? The skeptics become the minority, the ones that they believe are subjectively correct in oppressing a minority stand corrected because they're now in the minority because the people who have humility understand that the oppression of the minority does not hold truth as opposed to the beliefs of side skeptics.
Adding on to the point, I am really amazed on how far the idea of which we are portraying time and again, that the minority themselves are getting any chance of progress, any chance of a possible existence in the world because of the complete the characterization of a majority being epistemic human, you humble in nature. If there is a skeptic who doesn't understand the idea that African Americans need to be treated in the right sense, and if there is no epistemic humility inculcated inside them at this dire situation, very rightly brought about by side opposition and time, has the very fundamental core created that epistemic humility needs to be there in picture so as they understand the difference, they understand the change of track they need to work, they understand the frame of reference they need to look from, the more human, the more idealistic, the more better versions of themselves. And then in turn, if there are in the future, there are questions that needs to be raised, then the role of the minority skeptics step in this dominant paradigm of epistemic humility, which in turn will provide a better balance in the society and in turn provide a better balance to the world. Thank you so much.
Opposition, would you like to refute that?
Yes. The problem inside proposition's argument are two flawed assumptions. The first is that humility here somehow necessarily means empathy, which is that a majority person, once he gets access to some kind of truth, he's going to necessarily favor the minority group, right? They haven't told you why that will happen. Simply because you're open to the idea of multiple truths, how are you going to go towards the correct truth? And secondly, they tell you that minority is going to get a chance, right? But we've come here and told you that minorities won't get a chance because minorities themselves don't recognize their own oppression, given the fact that they've been social conditioned and the discourse that they've been surrounded with has been one that's been influenced by the majority. So they think like the majority. And secondly, they have no means to collectivize and share their experiences. And therefore, not only is there no recognition of minority oppression, there is no means for them to collectivize as well.
All right. Proposition, your question.
I'm glad you made the point that minorities do not understand their own oppression because the majority has dominated or kind of brainwashed them. Well, the majority in the current paradigm is the world of skeptics, right? So that is why we're trying to bring about the dominant change.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I think this is out of order. I think after my comment, we're supposed to proceed.
Yes, I'm asking for your question.
I apologize.
Okay, so if I may, there was a very, very broadcast sense of how fake news in the prevalent world is in turn something harmful, but very, very rightly said, in the world of skeptics, where there are people who are questioning every single thing that is prevalent in the society, the existence of the idea of fake news is first of all very much pushed down. Okay, let's make that thing very clear so the argument falters there itself. The second one, the idea that if there is a fake news in picture and this is something that the skeptics can oppose, then where is it that How does it any way justify the real news that needs to be accepted with epistemic humility in turn of the minority or the very, very wide range of people that side opposition brought in picture? How is that not more important to be brought out by the news of a inner world of skeptics as compared to that of the fake news, which predominantly won't exist in the paradigm that we are talking about? Thank you so much.
Opposition, your answer.
Is that a question?
Okay. Do you want me to repeat the question?
Yes, proposition, please repeat your question. Please make it brief.
Fair enough. Okay, in a world where fake news is not possible because the world is full of skeptics, let's make that very clear. How is it that fake news is even a topic in picture when there is real epistemic news that needs to be bought out in picture for the community that is actually portraying the real oppression, ideas, and other kinds of majority-dominated influences? Thank you.
Okay. Now, let's see how fake news exactly operates. First of all, a skeptic is a person who doesn't accept things as granted, right? He takes things with a pinch of salt. So if he's presented with, like, let's say some news, he doesn't accept it on its own. He maybe does his own research, applies his mind to it. And when he's presented with data that backs that news, only then he accepts that news as truth. So when he's presented with fake news, when he does his own analysis, when he does his own logical interpretation and research and finds out that, let's say, what Donald Trump is saying is actually false, then that fake news fails to serve its purpose. That fake news fails to like delude people. But fake news is still going to delude people in a world where epistemic humility is the dominant narrative, because there is no way to challenge any kind of fact. Because if you challenge fake news, the people who produce the fake news can very easily come and say that, listen, since everyone lacks knowledge, since there is no possibility of any objective truth, my fake news is just as good as the truth as your true news. In that paradigm, it becomes impossible for anyone to challenge any kind of fake news. And in that paradigm, it is the dominant narrative which is going to prevail, because more people will be able to come up with fake news than like the minority people who are numerically fewer in number.
Let us make it very clear that we understand how the news functions. Thank you for explaining to the whole house how fake news functions. But if skeptics were to be believed, then they would have still believed in this current majority rule as well. They would have still believed that there is no minority oppression happening on minorities. Who is bringing out the news to the skeptics that these minorities are being oppressed are the epistemic humile people who believe that the beliefs of skeptics are not completely true. There is room for improvement in the knowledge that they have, and that is how they bring that news to skeptics, and that is how we bring to light the minority oppressions that are happening.
Okay, adding on to a point. This is
no, sorry, please, we have
please,
a little.
I have to make a final comment, please.
No, I'm sorry. You can add it in a neck in your closing statement.
I'll make
opposition
a statement.
Yeah. All right. Opposition your question.
Yeah,
because we are short on time.
The question
yes.
is very simple. Can proposition, please give me a dictionary definition of the word skeptic.
Okay.
Am I
allowed to open the dictionary?
Let's go back to the opening speech, right? Kevin, can you give them the definition again? Can you give them the definition that the adjudicator who made the motion gave it as?
Yes. The skeptic is defined as a pessimistic naysayer and generally holds a questioning attitude towards one or more putative instances of knowledge and believes that all the knowledge they possess, a cap, is enough to know the truth. And based on these truths alone, do all the fundamentals of life function in turn, which may or may not lead to the dissolution of the truths of the world. Okay, is there a question that is followed for side opposition here? Because they just asked a very...
No, that's it. They will refute that if they can.
Yeah. Thank you. You answered my question. My comment on your answer is that you've lied. That's not the dictionary definition of skepticism. I will give you the dictionary definition for the benefit of the house and the judges. It is a skeptical attitude is an attitude which doubts the truth of something. It doesn't accept anything true without like being presented with evidence that backs that. Given that that's the definition of skepticism that we understand and that this house should understand, there is absolutely no reason that proposition has given you as to why a skeptic is necessarily going to be against like minority rule. There's absolutely no reason that they've given you as to why they cannot be minority skeptics who can be skeptics.
All right. Opposition, I'll have to ask you, this ends the refutation round. I would give the opposition to give their closing statement.
Team proposition or team opposition?
Opposition. I'm sorry. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yeah, sure. 20-second closing statement, is that it?
Yes, that one.
Yes. Unfortunately, this debate has boiled down to a discussion of what skepticism exactly means, even though that's something that should not be up for discussion at all, because objectively, skepticism, as has been defined by a dictionary, means an attitude where you don't accept things unless you present it with evidence. It's not like a stubborn child attitude where you reject everything no matter what. That's not what a skeptic is, and that's the kind of picture that they've tried to paint. They can't win this debate on this mischaracterization of skepticism. So unless they change their case in the last speech, which they cannot do, they have lost this debate.
Thank you, opposition, for your closing closing statement. Proposition, if you would like, kindly give your closing statement.
Yes. the concluding statement that side proposition wishes to propose is the very idea that side opposition came, that if there is tomorrow a fake news possible that delves into the society and creates a caracas, and it will be only the skeptics that will be ready to point out, it will take epistemic humility in turn to the majority to create a platform for these skeptics to create, come up and say that this is wrong, the idea is very fundamentally flawed. And in turn, that day, in a majority dominated world where epistemic humility functions, unlike a skeptic world where majority is functioned by skeptics, they will get a platform to actually bring out their point of this being a fake news or any right wrong statement, in turn providing a better, evolving and changing community. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Proposition, for your closing statement. With this, we come to the complete end of our refutation rounds. We will now begin with our closing speeches. The rules apply the same for as the opening speeches. Opposition, you have the go at the closing speech. Would you like me to restate the rules?
Yeah, just give me a text message at 3:30.
Okay, 3:30.
And 5.
Okay, 3:30, 4:30 and 5.
Yeah, 3:30, 4:30 and 5 is okay. Cool.
Okay.
Like, just let me know when I can begin.
You can begin. I will begin the clock when you start.
Okay. Judges and members of the House, it is important to clarify a lot of things in this debate for you to understand exactly which side this debate actually falls on. First of all, this is something that we've stressed on repeatedly, but I believe it is important to still clarify, is that side proposition has misunderstood and lied to you about what skepticism or a skeptic means. Understand, a skeptic is not some sort of stubborn child who never changes his opinion. A skeptic is someone who challenges any idea that he's received with, he engages with in debate, and if he's presented with information that contradicts his statement, that proves him wrong, he's willing to accept that change and move forward. That's how skepticism has been understood historically. That's how progress has happened, through debates, through discussions, and through discourse. So don't let them lie to you when they tell you that when majoritarian people are skeptics, they will never believe any other idea that is thrown to them. That is not true. That is not what a skeptic is. So unless and until they can give you any concrete reason as to why skepticism means anything else, their entire case based on a false understanding of skepticism cannot stand. Secondly, they talk about this idea of epistemic humility being required in society. Understand, this is something that also needs to be clarified. As the adjudicator who said the motion told us, that epistemic humility is something that can be used by a skeptic as a method of skepticism. So if I, for example, let's say challenge any dominant narrative, I can say that you are wrong because you don't have enough knowledge. But that's not something that you need to do in order to win this debate. Understand that the motion is about setting a world where the dominant narrative is epistemic humility. Even if the dominant narrative is skepticism, epistemic humility can still be present within at least the limitations of skepticism. But if epistemic humility becomes the dominant narrative, then truth is something that is absolutely lost. Because when there is no confidence or no knowledge of exactly what is objectively true or objectively false, then every claim becomes as right, as correct as every other claim. Therefore, a claim which says that Black people should not have equal rights is as good as a claim as Black people should have equal rights. This is as opposed to skepticism, where if you present this idea to a skeptic, when you tell them that, let's say, lower caste people should not have positive discrimination, then you can be skeptical about that and say that, no, you are wrong. My own research tells me that there has been historical injustice. There is research which shows that there is a need to give them like positive discrimination. And on the basis of that, we will like progress and give them like equal rights. This is how a skeptic mind will work, and this is and the opposite is how an epistemic humble mind will work. And that is why in our world where there's skepticism, where skepticism is the dominant narrative, minorities would be better off. Now let's understand how organic change has worked and will continue to work in a world of skepticism being the dominant narrative. Understand how debate and discourse works. Clearly the side proposition does not understand that. When two skeptics engage in a debate, or one skeptic engages in a debate with the other person, the truth always lies somewhere in between. It's not like the left always knows everything which is right, and the right always knows everything which is correct. It's only when ideas collide, when different theses and antitheses collide, that there is a synthesis. And it's only through debate, discussions, and discourse that the cons of each side can be removed, that the pros of both sides can be taken together, and the world can progress on its own. It's only through debate and discourse that slavery was abolished. It was only through debate and discourse that religious domination of the world was removed. When people came out and said that, no, I will not believe the fact just because the church is saying that that the sun revolves around the earth, I will not believe that fact. I will be a skeptic about that fact, that idea was challenged, and 300 years later, that idea got changed. Of course, any kind of change, any kind of organic change, when it progresses at a natural pace, is going to be slow. You can't have a world where women have equal rights instantly. You can't have a world where there is no racial injustice instantly. This is something that's going to take time, and we believe that that's something that's okay, because even though organic change will be slow, at least it will be long-lasting. This is as opposed to a world where epistemic humility prevails, where no matter what idea you portray, it can be easily shot down and delegitimized by saying that the people who portrayed that idea in the first place cannot have full knowledge, because they cannot be confident in the truth of what they're saying. And because they cannot be confident in the truth of what they're saying, their idea is a lie. This becomes specifically problematic for minorities to put forward their opinions. They haven't given you one good reason as to why minorities won't be skeptics, and minorities will always assume epistemic humility to be the truth. And understand that even minority movements are based on certain objective ideals. The equal rights movement of women, of the LGBTQ and Black people, has been based on the objective truth that we all people should be equal. But someone from the majority can come and say that no, there cannot be any true knowledge about that, and therefore that idea should be rejected. On the basis of that, minorities will suffer. We are very, very proud of those.
Thank you, opposition, for your closing speech. We now ask the proposition to provide us with their closing speech. Proposition, would you like any time signatures?
Yeah, just give me a few seconds to gather my thoughts, and I'll tell you about the time stipulations, all right?
Okay. Right, can we start?
Yeah, so give me a time bell at 1, at 3, and at 4:30.
You would like a bell?
Can you just
or put a message? Chat box? I'll put a message in the chat box, yes.
Please start the time when I start speaking.
Yes, I will.
Ladies and gentlemen, judges and observers, during the beginning of the debate, the adjudicator came and told us that skepticism is something that is based off of subjective correctness of the person's beliefs. They believe on their subjective correctness, and that is why they do not accept the truth. And when they are faced with facts that challenge their subjective correctness, their beliefs, is when a skeptic changes their opinions. This was a very clear definition given by the adjudicator, and that is why House Proposition did not feel the need to reiterate it during the debate. But as we saw during the refutation round, side opposition needed clarification because they lost their train of thought, because there was a lot of difference between objectivity and subjectivity of skepticism. Let's come to a very big point that the debate has pivoted around. That it's the majority that overpowers the minority, and that the oppressions of the minority do not come up when that happens. Let's read the first sentence of a debate. In a world of skeptics, we need change, is what the motion mentions. The world of skeptics currently is the majoritarian ruler, is the majoritarian power that is dominating the minority oppressions. These skeptics are tended to believe that these minority people have not been oppressed, right? And because epistemic humility is in minority is why these opinions of the skeptics are being difficult to change. The second point that side opposition very rightly brings up is that organic changes are slow. why do you think it took so many years for India and other countries to declare transgender marriages as legal? Why do you think child abortion legalization is such a slow process? It's because the skeptics believe in their subjective correctness that there cannot be more than two genders unless a very slow scientific minority of epistemic humile people are convincing skeptics otherwise, which is where they're changing their opinions. So if in our paradigm, epistemic humility is the dominant status, that is where skeptics are kept in check. Not just that, these organic changes that are so pivotal, minority oppression that is so important in today's world to be addressed, will be at the top of the radar because people with epistemic humility believe that the knowledge that they have is not paramount, is that there is room for improvement. When we bring the example of the church, we also try to mention that they were a bunch of skeptics who did not believe what Galileo was saying. Galileo believed that epistemic humility. He believed that the earth revolves around the sun, but the church did not believe it. And in a very clear case of majority dominating over minority, which was epistemic humility, Galileo was imprisoned. That was what is happening. That is still happening. And that is why there is an urgent need to change the paradigm, because these organic changes that you mentioned are so slow need not be that slow. These are very pivotal to how the world functions. What this side has today done, side proposition, is put epistemic humility in a very positive light with the backing of skeptics in minority, because obviously we have already conceded to the point that skeptics are important to epistemic humility to keep the truths in check. But if they become a majoritarian rule, if they are a dominant paradigm, as they have already been, minority oppressions will continue. The changes will still be slow. Time people, what is the time? I lost track. All right, 3 minutes.
You have 1 minute remaining.
I would also like to bring in the fact that they mentioned fake news and how skeptics believe is that the news that we're fed currently is the truth, unless a very small minority of epistemic humile people are trying to convince the status quo that this news is false, the news that skeptics are currently portraying in your dominant paradigm is false, that this is the truth, and that is when the true news is reported. So in our paradigm, false news has a lesser probability of succeeding than true news. So That's a win. That's a huge win on side proposition, where we believe we take away the debate, right? Now talking, I'll address the chief guest and the guest of honor. Sir C.P. Singh, you've serviced 36 years in the army. If the army had really believed in skeptics and understood that there is no room for improvement in how a human body can function and give to the army, would there have been prosthetic muscles and legs provided to the people who lose their legs and arms in battle? Ma'am Nidhi Salgame, you led a team of women to Nepal's treacherous roads. If skeptics were to be believed, you would have never led that team. You would have always been under the assumption that women can never lead charge, women can never brave these treacherous roads. But you had epistemic humility. You knew you could do better. And that is why you proved skeptics wrong. And that should be the dominant paradigm, is what we are saying. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Proposition, for your closing speech. With this, we now come to the end of the debate. Did the Proposition find any new? Did the Opposition find any new statements in the Proposition's closing speech? Opposition?
Sorry, we allowed to respond to the final speech?
No. Did you find any new points made?
No.
Okay. Proposition, did you find any new points made? Okay, you're good. Thank you. So, yes, we come to the end of this debate. Thank you both teams for your conduct and behavior during this debate. The panel is now open for our judges and adjudicator and our audience to pose their questions and their feedback. Thank you. Before this, audience, if you want to pose your questions, you will have to leave it in the live chat and I will read it out. Judges?
I now request the host, Tanisha, to take over from here.
Yes. Well, that was a very intense yet refreshing and enthralling debate. Our zealous participants have indeed proven that debates are one of the most efficiently effective ways to find solutions. Before we go ahead, I would like to apologize for the network lag during the start of the debate, where the judge's introduction wasn't quite audible. We welcome our esteemed panel of judges. Our first judge for today is Kashish Chhabria, who is a counseling psychologist and international inspirational speaker, a life clarity and transformation coach, and an entrepreneur by profession. Just recently, she received the Rex Karmaveer Chakra and Global Fellowship Award in association with the United Nations for her work. Thank you, ma'am, for taking time out from your busy schedule and being a part of this event. Our next judge is Meera Bharwani, who has a diverse experience for more than 17 years in training students. She has an expertise to teach both business communications and literature. She has taught at a wide array of institutes like BJTI, Sardar Patel Institute of Technology, Xavier Institute of Engineering, Narasimha Reddy Institute of Management Studies, Champlin College in Vermont, USA, Thakur College of Engineering and Technology, and Ram Narayan Ruhiya College, among others. We are overjoyed to have you today with us. And last but not the least, we have Roli Srivastava, who is an award-winning journalist with the Thomson Reuters Foundation and reports on gender, health, migration, and slavery in supply chains, focusing mainly on India's marginalized communities. In a career spanning over two decades, she has worked with major Indian newspapers, including The Hindu, where she was deputy editor, and The Times of India, where she was editor special projects. Her investigation won her the Fetisov Journalism Award Bronze in 2019 and a nomination for Journalist of the Year in Drum Online Media Awards. She's a great guest faculty at media schools and a speaker at International Journalism, and we are very proud to have you with us. Now I would like to ask the judges if they have any feedbacks to give the participants and help them with the debate. I would like to proceed with our judge, Meera Bharwani, ma'am.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, we can.
Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
What I would say is that both the teams were very good and well-organized, well-spoken. But I would not like to make any analysis of the arguments over here. The other judges can do that. Being from the English department, I would like to point out one or two language aspects. I don't know the names of the participants, but one of them had the habit of saying right, 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 right. After every few words, this participant was saying right, right, right. So try and avoid that in a debate, because in a debate, it is not just the arguments, but also your diction and your vocabulary. The second thing that I would like to point out is somebody used the word probability. It is not probability, it is probability. So please make that correction in your pronunciation. Probability, not probability. That's all I will say. Thank you.
Do any of the judges have any other feedbacks that they can give to the students or the participants? Soli, ma'am?
Yep. Hi, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, great. So I enjoyed the debate immensely, and I think both the teams were very strong with their line of argument. And like Ms. Meera Bhavnani, she gave her tips. I'll just give one, that when we are reporting, when we are writing our news reports, we are told to pass the granny test, which is write things that even your grandmother would understand, and write the most complicated things that are the easiest to understand, so they travel wider. So you reach a larger audience with points made simply, with anecdotes, with current day examples. Some of you nailed it in this debate, and you'll see it from the results. So, but both teams did a great job. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Kashish, ma'am, any inputs, anything?
A very good afternoon to all, and I must admit that the participants did an amazing job of putting forth their viewpoints, along with being competitive and throwing back points, which perhaps the opposite, opposite team would have a tough time with. These guys really nailed it, perhaps even psychologically turning it at some points and cross-questioning their own belief system, and which was thrown back by the other participants. It was a fun moment to watch how they are dodging each other's points. The way the spirit has been carried forward of this debate is commendable. I really enjoyed even looking at them. The calmness and the composure of the teams was worth noting. Meera ma'am, can you help me with this? Sorry. I really liked it. And ma'am, where did I go wrong in this? Could you help me correct the line there?
Was noteworthy.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Was noteworthy.
Yes, was noteworthy. So thank you so much for this correction. And I must say that all the four participants, you guys have done an immensely amazing job in doing your research. And fearlessly that you all have gone forward taking this so well. Hats off to you guys. Kudos to all of that. Thank you.
So we have two questions from the in the chat box. One is from an adjudicator, and the other is from an anonymous member of the audience. Both questions are for the proposition. If you could please read the chat box.
So moderator, can you read out the question for the people who are present in the
chat? Sure, okay. Yeah. Given that epistemic humility leads to denial of determinism, how does proposition suggest any objective societal truth, since societal truths are premised on some level of determinism? That's question one by our adjudicator.
Hello.
Hello, we can hear you.
Hello.
Proposition, we can hear you.
Okay, I'm not aware of the network bandwidth, but if you can hear me, okay, if you can hear me by any chance. Okay, we understand that epistemic humility leads to denial of determinism. Yes, we understand the idea that there's something to be determined. And I believe in turn, the second question also leads to the fundamental crux of the same idea, that how do you come up with on determinism, basically. Everything has to be determined, very rightly said by side opposition, with the current idea that there is thesis, antithesis, and synthesis. We are understanding the idea that there is something called epistemic humility, which in turn is suggested, is created, and that as a system works together to understand what societal, objective societal truths are right or wrong. Different parts of the society have different frameworks of thinking and have different ideas. And it's not wrong to say that there are certain societal objective truths that are very fundamental and very necessary to live with. And these, on the questioning of skeptics, will in turn provide the idea that yes, these are fundamental, these cannot be changed. These truths have their stand in the society just as they are. And then in turn, they will be determined as right or wrong, which in most of the cases, if they are objective societal truths, as mentioned by the adjudicator, they will hold its ground, again, through well-mentioned thesis, antithesis, and synthesis. But if there are certain societal truths through frameworks which in turn work for both the cases, and in turn a majority or an idea of determinism is associated with the person having the epistemic humility, then that in case allows a situation to be created where this thought, this objective truth that needs change is brought up in picture, given a platform, and in turn determined. So very, very rightly said by Sir Adjudicator, we understand that objective societal truths do not need to be changed. For example, if I say that it's wrong killing a person, there will be a community sitting and understanding and determining it within a world of skeptics, with question, with debate. But in turn, later on, in epistemic humility related society, there will be a few skeptics who will be questioning it. And at the same time, the community understanding the importance of how it needs to be determined, a flow in which it needs to be determined.
I would like to add by saying that the question posed that with epistemic humility in the world, there is no knowable truth. How do you come to agree on any major topic? This is a little deviation from the characterization of the house proposition, right? We're saying that in our house, epistemic humility will be the dominant paradigm, and that skepticism will be the secondary paradigm. What happens when epistemic humility is a dominant paradigm is, first, that there's no knowable truth. There is truth. Epistemically humile people understand that there is truth, but they do not put a cap over it of a subjective correctness. They understand that there is room for improvement or disagreement of that truth. When skeptics define knowable truth, they put a cap on that truth. They believe that this is the basis from which we have to build on. If this basis is no longer there, then we cannot build on it. And the building has to be provided, the foundation building has to be provided by the people who are epistemic, right? So that is how you decide on any major topic, is by the discussion between both the parties, which our house currently accommodates.
Adjudicator, I hope that answers your question.
I think the question addressed to side opposition.
Okay, sure, here.
Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Yes, so I'll take the question that Anusha had asked me. Anusha, thank you for your question, firstly. And my response...
I would like to read the question out before so that the others hear. Yes? Okay. One question is from our faculty member. The opposition is very, very conveniently assumed that the skepticism they're referring to will always bring change in the right direction. Isn't starting off at a neutral point still better than starting from a point of denial?
Yeah, thank you for that question, ma'am. My response to that is twofold. I'll first address neutrality and then starting point. Now, we tell you that starting from a neutral position is bad, because when there are a set of claims that are neutral and don't have more value than the others, placed in a real world where there is power that exists, where both sides have agreed that majoritarian groups have greater power, the narratives that support, or the truths that support the majoritarian group, will be those that come to the forefront, right? And I explain this in the form of how social conditioning, discourse, all of these things are dominated by powerful groups. But secondly, why starting points are useful, and this is something exclusive to skepticism and not epistemic humility, is we've told you how the starting point is based on certain universal presumptions, based on objective wrongs, right? We've told you about how life is important, and therefore killing someone is wrong. And that kind of universal presumption is something that operates in favor of minorities, right? And therefore, when you subsequently have debates and you try to find out other truths that are not these objective truths, you can verify those objective truths not only against these starting points that everyone agrees on, but you also have other independent evidence verified against this, right? So therefore, in this world, you're left in a position where you can debate and discourse and find the truth, as against people simply stubbornly questioning each other and not reaching any consensus. And we'll tell you that a lack of consensus is detrimental on the minorities and not the majority.
We have another question for proposition.
Yeah. I'll read out the question and then I'll answer it.
Okay.
In sure. A skeptical world, truth prevails. If your proposal is to be accepted, only evidence will fortify it. How will the proposition go about accepting new surgent ideas in their proposed world? Okay. I'll explain how the house functions once again. In a skeptical world, truth prevails, but the topic of discussion for the veracity, the topic that is to be discussed is bought on by epistemic people, right? Because they've done the research on that topic. They found something that challenges the beliefs of the skeptic, is why they bring it to the table. There's a discussion between the skeptics and the epistemic people, upon which, after getting conclusive evidence, it is accepted or rejected, as rightly mentioned in the question. Now, when we say, how in our paradigm are we going to accept new surgent ideas? We're still accepting new surgent ideas, right? Because both of the parties are still in the paradigm. What we're saying is that there'll be more ideas brought to the table now, since the skeptical world is not suppressing the epistemic humility of people. And that is why we'll have a catalyzing effect in how the slow organic changes are happening. I hope that answers your question.
Last question is for the proposition too. In a world of epistemic humility, where there is no knowable truth, how do you come up to agree on one on any major topic?
I think the answer that I just gave was...
Oh, you answered for both? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, then that concludes our question and answer session. This is the end of the debate. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, Side Opposition. It was lovely facing you all.
Yeah. Thank you, Side Proposition. It was a really fun opposition.
A huge shout out to the organizers for smoothly running this competition.
Yeah.
And to the judges.
Yes. A huge round of applause to the organizers for conducting this in a very, very, very core, very core debates with high volume information. And thank you for the judges and the adjudicators as well throughout the debates, also for their feedback, because we are very much refined right now because of your kind of indulgence. Thank you.
Thank you, participants and moderator. We would like to move on and...
are we supposed to leave the call?
No, just a second. Yeah. So coming to our chief guest, our chief guest for today is retired Major General C.P. Singh. He was commissioned into the Indian Army in December 1979. And after 36 years of meritorious service in the Indian Army, he retired from active service on the 31st December 2015. General C.P. Singh was awarded mention in dispatches by the President for gallantry in OP Pawan, which we have already mentioned. He has also been awarded commendation card by four Army commanders for distinguished service in various appointments. He's a three-time cancer survivor. The young veteran is a fitness enthusiast, and he goes cycling 12 kilometers, walking 6 kilometers every day, along with a keen interest in golf and other sports. We would like to greet him, and sir, we would like your feedback or any views or anything on this debate.
Sir, you're mute. You're on mute, sir. Kindly unmute yourself.
Okay, can you hear me? Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, good afternoon, namaskar, and Jai Hind to all of you. I'm so privileged and I would say singularly honored to be part of this audience, a very learned audience, I must say. And I have myself learned a lot from the proceedings since morning. I've been hearing that. And, you know, I feel young. When I got this invitation to connect with the millennials debating on various issues, I had two other experiences. Once I was ADG NCC when I was dealing with about 60,000 cadets in the Kerala and Lakshadweep. And secondly, I was Dean of Student Welfare in MIT University, where I dealt with the young teenagers or college students like you. And it's probably added a few years to my life, and I feel young. So I accepted this invitation. Before I come to the subject, since the president, principal, and the student council is here, let me thank all of you for calling me. And I had this bad habit of, you know, pointing out what is wrong. So now that you made it me wait for about an hour extra, kindly grant me 2 minutes more to speak. When I joined MIT University as a Dean of Student Welfare, I found that the Vice Chancellor would come first, followed by the staff and then the students. And we had to send messages to call the students, and then everybody said, sir, kya ho sakta hai? Students to aise late hi aate hain. This is an educational institute. Punctuality is the first virtue that you teach to your students. And I'm sure the director and the principal are listening. So I had a tie up with the vice chancellor. I said, sir, I'm a Fauji, let's change the system. So he said, done. So when thereafter, whenever the event was there, the vice chancellor would come dot in time and we would start the event even if there are two students. The word spread in 15 days, 1 month, and then that the event will start in time. You don't have to, you know, and we will embrace the people who come late from the staff and other things. And slowly we changed the culture. And then everybody used to be there 10 minutes before the conduct of the event. And the event would go by the clock. Sorry to say that, I'm a 4G. Now coming to the topic for the today. Very great topic that you've selected, you know, critique. And if I would say, in the Indian society, we have always welcomed critics with a positive mind, whether it was Kabir, it was Rahim, or it was Raja Ram Mohan Rai. And that reminds me, if I just read out one, you know, from the Kabir, Nindak Nere Rakhiyo, Angan Koti Chavai, Bin Sabun, Bin Pani, Nirmal Kare Subhai. Yani, aap ek critic ko apne paas rakhiye. Wo bina pani, bina sabun ke, aapke man ko, aapke swabhav ko saaf rakhta hai. तो उसको अपने घर में रखिए क्रिटिक को. योर क्रिटिक इज योर बेस्ट फ्रेंड इफ यू से दैट इन इंग्लिश. सो ऑफ कोर्स टू एक्सेप्ट क्रिटिसिज्म इज यू गॉट टू हैव अ लार्ज हार्ट. एंड इफ यू रिमेंबर द वन ऑफ द यू नो एड्स यूज्ड टू कम अर्लियर ऑफ टाटा स्टील, वी एनकरेज डिसेंट टू ग्रो. एंड नीचे एक कैप्शन होता था, वी ऑल्सो मेक स्टील. आई थिंक दे हैव प्रोबब्ली टेकन इट आउट. I like that ad very much because the dissent should be encouraged and handled with confidence. Then only the organization grows, then only the society grows. If we don't have dissent, if we kill the dissent, we have had dictators in the past, in the present, who do not accept dissent, and those perish with time as you come. For the growth of any organization, any society, any country, we must accept criticism with a fair amount of embrace to make some positive changes. Let me give you a personal example. I was selected in the army when I was a student like you, 20 years, and I had a roommate who was selected into medical college. So he, after joining the medical college, got into a little so-called bad company. He started smoking, drinking, and you know, all sorts of vices. He'll miss the classes and all. I came to know, I debated for some time whether I should bring it to the notice or no. Then I wrote a letter to his father. Those days, writing letter with manuscript was in thing. So I wrote a 3-4 pages letter to his father. And then I debated in my mind, if I write my name, let it go anonymous, or should I write my name? Because if I write my name, I'll lose a good friend, maybe. But then it said, if I stand for something, I must write my name. I don't believe in anonymity. So I wrote my name and sent it to his father. His father got the letter, read it, and he summoned him. And he said, I have got a complaint against you. And this is what people have said. You are doing all these nonsense, because he was staying in the hostel. So his father was not aware. And I will not tell you the name of the person who has written this. So you know what he said, my friend? He said, you don't have to tell me the name. I know only two persons. Either it could be X, I will not name, or it could be CP. My name, because these are the two people who are really concerned about my welfare. Rest are all fair weather friends. And we today, till date, are very good friends for last 50 years, and we honor each other. He's got his own political views. I have my difference. We debate it out, like you all are debating, but we still remain very, very good friends till date, and wish each other good morning every day. So the ability to accept criticism and the ability to stand up and bring out the changes in the society for the betterment of the organization is a very great virtue, which I'm sure you will develop that as you go in life beyond this debate. That is a carry home that you take from this debate, all those who are listening, and imbibe in your career, in your life. To conclude, I would say, stand up for what you feel is right. Even if you stand alone, you remember Gandhiji started this movement alone. And फिर कहते हैं ना अकेला चला था मैं लोग मिलते गए और कार वहां बनता गया and finally the Britishers had to quit. So even if you feel justified for a point and you feel nobody will support you, stand up and be counted. I'm sure the world will join you and change the system that you feel needs to be changed. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words. Moving on to our guest of honor, she is Ms. Nidhi Salgame, the first woman to drive from Delhi to London and the first Indian to drive the Pole of Cold and on the Road of Bones in Siberia. She's an extreme terrain driver, outdoor educator, off-road jeeper, and overland adventurer who specializes in trains in extreme overlanding. She created history by leading the first team of women drivers to Lhuma Thang in Nepal, one of the most treacherous roads in the world. She brings hunger to go where no one else has and is a source of inspiration and empowerment to all women and men alike. We are truly honored to have her here as a guest of honor. Ma'am, would you like to give some words of wisdom to the participants?
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for this opportunity and thank you for such a sweet introduction, Tanisha. I've just loved listening to all of you and has taken me back to, you know, my days when I used to debate. So it's a lot of deja vu that happened in the last couple of minutes. Thank you for this opportunity. I think the topic for the debate was so apt because that's exactly the turmoil that we are going through and have been going through, I guess, for many years. I, for one, have thrived in taking on the status quo. I mean, and to be able to challenge and, you know, that's what shaped me as a person. And therefore, given that, I don't know what I would do in a world without skeptics, to be honest with you, because I think they egg me on at some level. That said, I think the other end of the spectrum, like your debate rightly brought out, the epistemic humility bit is something that's as important. As much as the debate might want us to believe that we exist at two ends of the paradigm, I think it's a bit of both that eventually will work and, you know, make society go forward or help us, you know, forge new paths, because it's never an either or in life. And congratulations to all four of you who were debating each other, the proposition and the opposition team. I mean, fantastic hearing you all, but do remember it's always a bit of both and it's never an either or, and that's how you make it through. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for that wonderful little piece of advice. On behalf of everyone present here, we would like to extend a big thank you to all of our judges for being here and sharing their insights and expertise. In a debate, rather pull to pieces the argument of thy antagonist than offer him any of thy own, for thus thou wilt fight him in his own country. A good speaker is one who not just puts forth his own ideology successfully, but also listens to the opponent, and not with the intention of answering back, but with that of understanding his viewpoint. With this, I invite our principal ma'am Dr. Srija Anikrishnan to announce best speaker for CRMD 2020.
A very good afternoon to all of you. Let me congratulate all the participating teams who are very enthusiastic for their commendable debating skills and the breadth of knowledge on the various topics. So the best speaker of CRMD 2020 is Mr. Joel Matthew Cherian from CMD 13. Congratulations to Mr. Joel.
Okay, so before we move on to the results, I'd like to talk about the adjudication process. Adjudicators must watch the debates objectively, putting aside their own views on the motion. They should be unbiased with an incredible amount of knowledge and the subject about the debate, apart from being thorough with the rules of debating. I now request our Dean of Student Affairs, Dr. Deepak Bhoer, to come announce the best adjudicator for the Constance R. Rodericks Memorial Debate 2020.
Good afternoon, everybody. It was a nice debate, finals, and most of the rounds went so nicely. People have discussed in great detail, and really we thoroughly enjoyed. I thank Major General C.P. Singh, sir, for taking time out and remain here as a chief guest. Also, Nithi Madam, Principal Madam, our father, Reverend Father Peter, sir, Father Valerian. Adjudicator plays a very important role, as it is said by our comparer. And, he or she gives, insight out and a lot of feedback that what kind of analysis we have to do and which way we have to go ahead with and what are the lacunas. I am sure that all the 32 teams and the participants will be taking back good suggestion from the adjudicator. So I'm very pleased to announce the name of the adjudicator. The best adjudicator in CRMD 2020 is Tanish Pradhan. Thank you.
Congratulations, the winner. Yet one more year has come and gone, but the debate seemed to linger on. This year we dealt with social adversities. Let's make changes with the same intensities. With this, let's invite our editorial secretary, Ms. Saloni Khanna, to raise the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, everyone. There has been a slight delay in the results of the finals, which we will be announcing later. So I will be moving on with the vote of thanks. The key to holding a logical argument or debate is to allow oneself to understand the other person's argument, no matter how divergent the views may seem. From the 32 extraordinarily proficient teams, we have seen how many rigorous rounds of debating have been gone through. My heartiest congratulations to everyone who made it to this event. I extend my warmest gratitude to our chief guest, retired Major General C.P. Singh, and our guest of honor, Ms. Nidhi Salgame, who were able to grace our event with their presence. I would like to also thank our Reverend Father Peter D'Souza, Reverend Father Valerian D'Souza, and our beloved principal, Dr. Srija Unnikrishnan, for always standing by with us. Our wonderful judges, I want to thank you all for taking the time out of your lives and out of your busy online schedules to judge our participants wholeheartedly while being an absolute blessing for us. I also want to take an opportunity to congratulate and thank the numerous prestigious teams who made it to our event. IITs from Madras, Goa, Tirupati, national law colleges from Gujarat, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, a number of participants from Delhi University, NITs from Durgapur and Calicut, to name a few. Each and every one of you was a part of making this event the huge success that it was. my lovely audience. Every event is incomplete without you, and even during a pandemic, you made it a point to attend our debates, which shows your passion, and we admire everything you stand for. My faculty in charge is Mrs. Sundari Prabhavati and Mrs. Garima Tripathi. Thank you for guiding us at each step and making sure that this event turned out just as we had visualized it to. I do not think any of this would have been executed with such precision and perfection. And the utmost credit goes to my team, Students Council for the year 2020-21, who helped execute our dream of an online CRMD for the first time ever and worked endlessly towards it. We hope to continue the great legacy of our college in the years to come. Cheers to everyone. Have a good day. Thank you so much. We will be announcing the results later. So I request everyone to leave the meeting. Thank you so much for being a part of Conchisa Rodrigues Memorial Debate 2020.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, Saloni.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone.